This is Professor Rod Evans, and this is the first test review for Business Ethics for Old Dominion University, Philosophy 303. What I'm going to be doing today is going over the material, of course, for the first exam. There are going to be two exams, the one upcoming, the first one, and then the final exam, and there are reviews for each. And this is the review for the first exam, which will cover the first three chapters in the book I just held up a moment ago. Now, let me talk about the nature of the test. The test is going to consist of 35 true false questions, 15 multiple choice questions, and 4 essay questions from which you're to choose exactly 2. Each of the objective questions, that is, each true, false, and multiple choice question, will count exactly 1.5 points, and each of the 2 required essay questions will count 12.5 points. For the essays, you can write between 150 and 250 words. Let me just put it this way. The way things are set up right now, and they're subject to change, but this will certainly be true for the summer of 2020. I'll be emailing the exam to students, and it'll be scheduled for when the exam is, and there'll be a time limit, but the exam will be open book, open notes. Okay. But in any event, that's the way things are going to be for summer 2020. There may be a different delivery of way of delivering the exam in the future, or different. They may be taken under different conditions. But in any event, I can assure you this, or whoever is going to be watching this, that this will cover the content of the exam. So let's go over the review for the first business ethics exam. First thing you need to do is to be able to distinguish fashion and other standards from moral standards. So how does the book draw some distinctions? Well, moral standards, the book says, and I think a lot of people would agree with this, typically concern behavior that can seriously affect human welfare. And you know, whether you eat your mashed potatoes with a spoon or your fingers or a fork, normally it can have some effect, but won't seriously affect human welfare in the way that violations of basic moral norms would. And furthermore, moral standards will typically take priority over other standards. So for example, if you are all dressed up and you're uniquely able to jump into a swimming pool to save a drowning child, you can't get out of that obligation by saying that, well, but it would be bad manners for me to be sopping wet in these clothes. So typically, moral standards will take priority over other standards. Moreover, the soundness of moral standards will depend on the adequacy of reason supporting them. So moral standards, again, are supposed to have reasons behind them. Presumably the reasons behind them will relate to the need for people to reduce or eliminate social conflict and reduce and or eliminate suffering. Second thing you need to know, that's the second question, is whether moral standards require reasons, and the answer is yes. Now the other thing is, and this will be number 3 if one were to number these on the review sheet, how our author describes the contingent relationship between morality and law. To say that morality and law are contingently related is to say that what is legal in a given jurisdiction may or may not be moral, and what is illegal in a given jurisdiction may or may not be immoral. Think of things that, were illegal in the past, as in the United States, helping slaves escape before the American Civil War, helping to protect Jews and Gypsies and other persecuted groups in Nazi Germany. Well, those were illegal, but of course that doesn't imply that those things must be morally wrong. And think about things that are legal, but may be most lies and most broken promises are legal, that doesn't necessarily imply they are morally right. Now, you need to know also whether our author believes morality requires a religious basis. The short answer to this is that he does not. He in no way criticizes religion. He realizes that many people learn about morality through religion, but he denies that one must be religious to think and reason morally and to make reasonable moral judgments. He thinks all of us have an interest in getting along with one another, in reducing or preventing social conflict, in reducing or in preventing suffering. And on because of those common interests, we can make moral judgments even without necessarily agreeing on various religious beliefs. Okay, so furthermore, what ethical or cultural relativism is and how it's been criticized, okay? So cultural relativism pretty much says, it's a theory, pretty much saying that standards of morality, standards of normality, standards of rationality or reasonableness, and standards of beauty are created by, dependent on, and relative to each culture. Now, what that implies is that, of course, we mentioned standards of morality. So according to that view, what standards of right and wrong will be can vary from one culture to another, and each culture is the final arbiter of what is right or wrong within it, and that there's no way that any culture can be mistaken about what is right or wrong within it. Now, how has that been criticized, the ethical component of cultural relativism? Well, there have been a number of ways in which it's been criticized, and our author, Shaw, has criticized that view. For example, it denies that any standard such as the Golden Rule can have objective validity apart from the actual customs and practices of particular cultures. Cultural relativism, again, we're talking about its ethical dimension, seems to imply that whatever norms and rules have been generally accepted and institutionalized are necessarily right simply because they're popular, regardless of how individuals and minorities are treated. Critics of cultural relativism assert that the Nazi treatment of unpopular minorities was wrong, regardless of its popularity. And so, I mean, other people have criticized it in further ways, and including our author. The position seems to argue or imply that that there's no such thing as moral progress, only moral change. And yet, many people would argue that thousands of years ago, the norm was that what was right or wrong was determined by one's tribe, and so that it was thought that it was wrong to sell spoiled meat to members of one's tribe, but it was quite permissible to sell spoiled meat to those outside the tribe. And some people came along, Jesus and others came along and said, look, everyone is your neighbor, everyone is worthy of moral concern. And there are many people who have argued that that was a hard-won insight and that it wasn't simply moral change, a belief that everybody matters, everyone's your neighbor, that it was an expansion of the moral imagination. And so some people think that, that's an example of moral progress, and there's the possibility that some individual, according to critics of cultural relativism, could be wiser than the multitudes, as when Martin Luther King Jr. criticized the racist, segregationist Jim Crow laws of the South and went against those institutionalized laws. So some people think it's possible for some individual to be wiser than the multitudes, and that we shouldn't equate what is right simply with what is popular. Now, the next item on the review sheet is what Albert Carr has to say about moral principles and business. Albert Carr asserted that just as the card game poker has rules that allow for deception or bluffing, so business has a distinct set of rules and expectations that permit deceit and deception. Against Carr, critics submit that any conduct that can seriously affect human welfare is, in virtue of that fact, subject to ordinary moral norms. The critics say further that while people expect to encounter bluffing, we don't expect as consumers to buy contaminated peanut butter presented as safe. We do have laws against fraud, which can, of course, invalidate business exchanges. Now, number seven, if one were numbering these things, what you need to know is why our author thinks that our consciences are fallible. By the way, just one quick thing about, I want to mention another quick thing about the position of Carr. I mean, Carr said that it's true that people volunteer for poker normally and they expect deception. Again, people don't consent to business fraud, and I just wanted to reemphasize that point. Anyway, the next item is what does our author have to think about our conscience, and why does he think that our consciences are valuable, but they are still fallible? Well, our author, Shaw, says that while people's consciences should certainly be taken seriously and should give people pause, I mean, if their consciences are condemning some prospective action, a conscience may not be highly developed, or it may be contaminated by racism or other prejudice, or by an inaccurate assessment of consequences. Consequently, a conscience can be helpful, yet it is imperfect, and its convictions need to be examined. Okay? So some people who were had racist parents were taught conscientiously to oppose interracial eating and dating and marriage and so on. So the conscience, though valuable, is fallible. Let's talk about the next item on the review sheet. This would be number eight if one were numbering these things. Here is the thing. Why our author asserts that having moral principles involves a tendency to act according to them? Well, moral principles at bottom concern action and its evaluation. They tend to be action guiding. Consequently, we judge whether people possess particular ethical principles by whatever they usually try to, or whether they usually try to satisfy them, and whether they show regret or remorse when they fail to follow them. So you've heard the saying that you shall know people by their fruits. And so we look at people's actions to determine whether they are committed to the moral principles to which they pay lip service, at least. Let's look at number nine, if one were to number these. Whether utilitarianism is a consequentialist theory. Yes, utilitarianism is a consequentialist theory, since it judges actions or rules or moral codes according to their consequences. Okay, so the short answer is yes. Now, number 10, if one were to number these, what is a deontological theory? Well, what is a deontological theory? A deontological theory is simply a theory that, at least to some degree, holds that our moral duties depend on factors other than simply consequences. So, to the extent that a theory is deontological, to the extent that it's deontological, it's going to say that some actions can be intrinsically right, right in virtue of their natures. And some actions are going to be intrinsically wrong, wrong because of their natures. Now, if you want to think of a theory that's intended to be purely deontological or non-consequentialist, you could talk about Immanuel Kant's theory. Immanuel Kant, who lived from 1724 to 1804, had an ethical theory purporting to be purely deontological. Okay, so let's look at the next one. And the next one is the following. What do utilitarians believe? Well, all utilitarians want to maximize good consequences. All of them believe that morality and our duties are determined by the achievement of beneficial consequences. And the beneficial consequences can vary from one utilitarian theory to another, whether you're talking about pleasure, happiness, or satisfaction, or people's preferences. Okay, the next one. By the way, let me begin by, at least with some of these, to display the answers. Now, one thing I encourage you to do is to stop and pause the answers, to go over the material, to think about it. And in general, I think for each lecture, it's a good idea after 20 or 25 minutes to pause, to walk around, move around, to think about what you've had, been exposed to, and also maybe to sip on some water. But I think that would be a good thing. You definitely want to allow breaks while viewing this material. So let me begin showing you some of the stuff. Some of the stuff is going to be get sometimes a bit more complicated. Number 11, utilitarians assert that our moral duties are determined by the achievement of beneficial results, including pleasure, happiness, satisfaction. Number 12, it says the following. It wants you to know who some utilitarians are, and certainly J.S. Mill and Jeremy Bentham were both utilitarians. They're often called classical utilitarians because they believe that pleasure is the only intrinsic good and that we should maximize the net pleasure, the amount of pleasure created minus any suffering. Richard Brandt was also utilitarian, but not a classical one. He was a rule utilitarian, and he held that we need to find out what networks of rules will create the greatest benefit for each individual culture, and they will determine what is right or wrong within it. Okay, so now, next, this would be number 13 if one were numbering these. What is psychological egoism? Well, psychological egoism is a descriptive theory about human motivation. It says that all people always do what they believe will promote their interests. Notice, it doesn't talk about what should be or what ought to be. It's supposed to, purporting at least, to talk about what is. It's about human motivation and human action. It's supposed to describe. So, the definition of psychological egoism should not contain words such as should or ought. Okay, it says all people always do what they believe will promote their interests. Okay, further, what is ethical or rational egoism? Okay, ethical or rational egoism is a prescriptive or normative theory. Prescriptive means it's recommending behavior. Normative means setting up a standard. It usually expressed in one of two ways. The impersonal or universal form of it says that all people should promote their enlightened self-interest. Ayn Rand was an example of a person who believed in the universal impersonal form of ethical or rational egoism. The personal version of it says I, a specific individual, should promote my interest, but I don't believe that other people should promote their self-interest. So if Popeye the Sailor Man, if he were a person with ethical egoist, he would believe that he, that is Popeye, should promote his self-interest, but he wouldn't believe that all other people should promote their self-interest. If he believed that, he would be a universal and impersonal ethical egoist like Ayn Rand. Okay, now, again, the author, philosopher Ayn Rand was a universal ethical / rational egoist. While Rand, by the way, believed in individual rights and believed that rational egoists would realize the value of cooperation and mutual respect, there are some critics who disagree, saying that the universal version of ethical egoism cannot serve to resolve conflicting interests and so would lead to practical contradictions. Okay, so if two or more persons interacted, and it could be in one person's interest to mistreat another, but it's not in the other person's interest to be mistreated, whose interest should prevail? Well, we're not going to be able to resolve these issues. The question is whether rational egoism in its impersonal form can permit some reasonable limitations on what people can do in the name of their self-interest, limitations set by some defensible theory of individual moral rights. Ayn Rand thought that she had such a theory. But in any event, There are philosophers who don't think that such a theory is compatible with a commitment to rational egoism. Now, by the way, critics of personal ethical egoism don't think that it'll lead any self-contradictions, but they think that it could require or approve of antisocial actions performed to advance some individual's self-interest. Okay, you need to know furthermore how Mill and Bentham differed over the nature of pleasure. Okay, for Mill, pleasures can differ in quantity and quality. For Bentham, pleasures can differ only in quantity. Okay, so Mill believed that intellectual pleasures, other things being equal, are superior to purely physical pleasures. Certainly Bentham did not believe that. Bentham thought that that if you really believe that pleasure is the only thing that's intrinsically good, you have no reason to prefer one to another except for reasons of quantity. We don't need to go into that, but I do want you to understand that they differed over the nature of pleasure and whether pleasures can admit of differences in quality. The next one is how critics of utilitarianism talk about justice. Well, a major criticism of utilitarianism is the claim that it could approve of an action that maximized happiness but distributed it unjustly, resulting in the unfair treatment of individuals or minorities. Okay, so that is a major criticism, because utilitarianism is a maximizing theory. It says maximize what's good, and someone would say, well, look, you could end up maximizing what's good, and yet you could have, let's say, 99% of the people enslaving the other 1%, and they'd say, well, that doesn't mean it's right, because it could be unjust, that distribution. Next, you need to know the following. What did Kant mean by a goodwill? Well, you have a goodwill for Kant when you do what is right because it's right. Whoops. Let's try to get this a little bit better. That means also you're morally motivated. And that means when you're morally motivated, you've done something that's performed an act that's worthy of moral esteem. Okay, so you have a goodwill when you do what is right because it's right. That means you're morally motivated. And when you act with a goodwill, besides being morally motivated, you're doing something that is worthy of moral esteem. Okay. Another way to say this, okay, now, for Kant, a person who has a good will have a good will if he does or she does what is right because it is right, or acts for the sake of duty. It says later that for him, only a good will be unconditionally good. And further, a good will is not equivalent to sympathy or benevolence. Even though the benevolence means a good will, literally, that's not what he means by a goodwill. It's not connected to, in any way, to your feelings. Again, you have a goodwill when you do what is right because it's right. You act in accordance with duty, for the sake of duty. Okay, now, the other thing is, what does Kant mean by the categorical imperative? The categorical imperative for Kant is the ultimate moral standard, explaining the reason why any action is right or wrong. And you also need that. You also need to know, by the way, that Kant thought that all lying and all promise breaking are wrong. Okay, let me say this again. For Kant, the ultimate moral standard is this categorical imperative. Explains the reason why any action is right or wrong. He thought that all lying and promise breaking are wrong. All lying and promise breaking are wrong. Now, that might not even have followed from his categorical imperative, but we're not going to worry about that. But I do want you to know that he did believe that all lying and promise breaking are wrong. Now, and that would, okay, the next thing. What did W.D. Ross believe? Well, Ross was an ethical intuitionist. He was not a utilitarian. He believed that a morally conscientious person will recognize, weigh, and fulfill a diverse set of what he called prima facie duties. And prima facie duties, and I'll display this because things are getting a bit more complicated, are moral considerations of varying weight. The most serious or the weightiest prima facie duty in a particular context becomes one's actual duty. Okay, so if one were to display these, he was an ethical intuitionist, he was not a utilitarian, he believed that a morally conscientious person will recognize, weigh, and fulfill a diverse set of prima facie duties. Prima facie duties are moral considerations of variable and or varying weight. The most serious or the weightiest prima facie duty in a particular context becomes one's actual moral duty. How does this work out? Well, suppose you promise to meet someone for lunch. Well, in the absence of competing moral considerations or other prima facie duties, that would become your actual duty, okay, to meet that person for lunch if you promise to do so. But suppose you promise to meet someone for lunch, but you run into a friend on your way to lunch who desperately needs to be rushed to the hospital, to the emergency room. In that case, that situation, the prima facie duty to help out a friend who desperately needs to go to the hospital, that in fact would be a competing prima facie duty that would be weightier and that would override the other prima facie duty and then would become your actual duty, all things considered. Okay, so you can have two or more prima facie duties. They can be a variable weight. Normally they will be a variable weight. Usually we'll have a good grip on what should take precedence or priority over another. Sometimes we're not sure. And he says we're not sure that we did the right thing because of competing prima facie duties. Now notice how that differs from Kant's view, right? Kant said it's always wrong to lie. Doesn't matter the circumstances or the consequences. It's always wrong. It's always wrong to break one's promise. Well, obviously, Ross disagreed. And Ross thought that his theory was much closer to that of ordinary enlightened people than he thought Kant's theory. And Kant was wrong to think that some of these rules are just absolutes, that under no circumstances should one not tell the truth or not break a promise. Under no circumstances, Ross thought, so he thought Kant was wrong to say that it's always wrong to lie and it's always wrong to break promises. According to Ross, there are normally wrong to lie, according to Ross, and wrong to break a promise. But there are exceptional circumstances in which lying or breaking a promise can be justified, according to Ross. And I think he's right about that, according to the view of most people. Next, you need to know, we've determined that whether, okay, was Ross utilitarian? We've said no, because Ross thought it's good to be able to produce good consequences, but he didn't think that you could determine right and wrong simply by looking always at consequences and determining what has the best consequences. And he also believed that there are things that are just intrinsically right, intrinsically wrong, and we can't determine right or wrong simply by, again, determining what has the best consequences. Now, I've talked about what prima facie duties are, right? They're moral considerations of variable weight, and some can override others. Now, furthermore, what are supererogatory actions? Supererogatory actions are actions beyond the call of duty. A question arises whether ACT utilitarianism can recognize supererogatory actions, since the theory seems to require always doing what is maximally beneficial or optimific. So there may be at least some theories that would not admit the class of actions of supererogatory actions. But most people, I think, believe that it is possible for somebody to do something beyond a call of duty, something that was morally heroic, but was not morally required. Okay, how have people criticized utilitarianism from the standpoint of personal autonomy and goal seeking? Well, advocates of personal autonomy, including political libertarians, will often criticize utilitarianism as rejecting a zone of moral freedom in which individuals are free to do as they like so long as they don't harm others. Now, I may love to write, but utilitarianism says that my personal projects, however much I value them, must be subordinate to the general happiness. I mean, let's suppose that someone's mother is gravely ill for the last, 6 months of her life, and that person wants to devote almost all of his time to helping his mother, but let's suppose that person could be creating, computer software that would produce more good. Well, there are utilitarians who would say, unfortunately, that person needs to spend more time writing, creating computer software and less time taking care of his mother, whereas a lot of other people would say, no, as long as he's not directing harming others, that should be a free choice of his. Again, we can put this up here. I'll give you, of course, you can pause it. Advocates of personal autonomy, including political libertarians, often criticize utilitarianism as rejecting a zone of moral freedom in which individuals are free to do as they like so long as they don't harm others. I may love to write, but utilitarianism says my personal projects, however much I value them, must be subordinate to the general happiness or the greatest good for the greatest number. Okay, now, number 23, if one were numbering these, what is Nozick's theory of entitlement? What does it say? Well, Nozick wrote Anarchy, State, and Utopia, a libertarian work appealing to Lockean, capital Lockean, natural rights. Nozick held that people are entitled to their holdings, such things as their income, wealth, and whatever property they own, if they acquire them without fraud, violence, or the threat of violence, coercion. So that's what you need to know. Nozick wrote Anarchy, State, and Utopia, a libertarian work appealing to Lockean natural rights. Nozick held that people are entitled to their holdings, that would include their income, their wealth, and whatever property they own, if they acquire them without fraud, violence, or the threat of violence or coercion. Okay, now, 24, if one were numbering these things, how is Nozick's theory different from, how is Rawls' theory differ from Nozick's libertarianism and also from utilitarianism? John Rawls's theory of justice asked people to envision choosing social rules while thinking away any of their individual features that could bias them: sex, intelligence, abilities, current financial status, religion, ethnicity, etc. He thought that by choosing principles that are based on rational self-interest, stripped of special bias, people can arrive at fair principles of justice. Okay, so his theory of justice was designed to get people to envision social rules while thinking away individual features they have that could bias them. That's the whole idea of the veil of ignorance, right? And then we know also that he included the maxim and rule or strategy, right? And it says that when you're not fully sure of all the consequences of your actions, of your choices, try to minimize the worst that can happen to you, right? So if you do that, if you have the veil of ignorance, so you think away any personal features you have that could bias you, including your sex, your income, any skill set you have, religion, ethnicity, and so on. If you think that away, and you try to try to minimize the worst that can happen to you, then he says you're gonna end up getting rid of, or at least not even seriously entertaining, certain institutions, such as slavery, hereditary aristocracy, and religious caste systems. You're gonna want upward mobility. You're gonna want equality under the law. You can see how he's thinking and how there's a certain logic to the way he was thinking. Let's talk about the following. What is the maxim and rule? Well, I'll display this. The maxim and rule or strategy is a game theory concept. Rawls says that if people are rationally self-interested but largely uncertain of the outcomes of their choices, they will try to minimize the worst that can happen to them. For example, the original social contractors won't want the institutions of slavery lest that they should be slaves, right? Again, that's the maxim and rule. Rawls says that if people are rationally self-interested but largely uncertain of the outcomes of their choices, they will try to minimize the worst that can happen to them. For example, the original social contractors for Rawls won't want the institution of slavery lest they should be slaves. Now, furthermore, you need to know how Rawls's theory, again, is going to differ from Nozick's theory. And I want to say this. I want to say, you know, we talked about this, but basically I gave you some different, well, a key difference, really, of between the two is that Rawls did not believe in individual natural property rights, but thinks that the rules for property and for the distribution of income, in a sense, can be created by society generally or people generally. And with a special regard to those who are the least well off. We know also, okay, so we know that Rawls, unlike Nozick, didn't believe in natural property rights. We know that. But also, I want you to know, of course, we know that Nozick was not a utilitarian, but neither was Rawls, right? Rawls, we said this before, that we said that Rawls's position also differs from utilitarianism because we said, yes, Rawls wanted good consequences and especially was concerned about the most vulnerable and least favored members of society, the least fortunate. But Rawls's theory rejects any unqualified utilitarianism because he says that could lead to what some people call the utility monster. That could lead to a situation in which the majority are tyrannical in relation to minorities or individuals. And so Rawls also, his theory also differs from any kind of unqualified utilitarianism. Now, the other thing is you need to know what was the point of Nozick's Wilt Chamberlain example? Well, here's what I have. If people are free to choose, some people, including popular athletes, will make more money than others. Freedom includes the possibility of unequal results. Unequal results. Again, if you have a market-dominated economy, if you have very large differences in people's skill sets and in their values and in their self-discipline, and in their marketability, then what's going to happen is freedom will imply that you're going to have differences in wealth and income. And according to Nozick, that if you're trying to minimize freedom, or put it this way, if you're going to try to minimize differences in wealth and income in a market-dominated economy, you're going to have to forbid capitalist acts between and among consenting adults, according to Nozick. Okay, so I want you to know that. Now, why does libertarianism disapprove of what are called victimless crime statutes? Well, victimless crime statutes are those laws that prohibit behavior in which there's no complaining victim. That's one way to say it. And that is, so you're talking about things like adult gambling, adult use and consumption of pornography. You're talking about various drug use, drug possession by adults, let's say. And so these are part of what we call victimless crimes, and the laws behind them would be victimless crime statutes. Now, why do libertarians disapprove of such laws? Well, because libertarians see those laws as violating personal autonomy and unacceptably violating personal autonomy, a right to live one's own life as one wants, provided that one isn't violating others' rights. Okay. Libertarians believe that adults should be free to gamble, use and possess drugs, or have consensual sex with other adults. provided that they aren't violating others' rights to life, liberty, or property. Okay, so now, as to the essay preparation. Again, they're going to be, you'll get about, four essay questions from which you're to choose exactly two. And you may choose whatever two, obviously, you like, and then you'd be writing anywhere between 150 and 250 words, presumably, for each essay. One question is you need to know how to evaluate Carr's thesis about ethical principles being irrelevant to business. Okay? So you need to look at what Carr is saying. Carr is saying that business is is like the poker. It says it's got its own rules to a very large extent, and those rules can differ from many of the rules of ordinary morality. And he talks about personal morality, but I think he's thinking very largely of traditional religious morality, including Christianity, where morality is regarded as something tied to self-sacrifice. And see, so Carr really couldn't see how, he goes, well, how can you relate business to self-sacrifice? Isn't it about self-interest? But I think there are several problems with Carr's view of when it comes to business ethics. I mean, one, and then generally they're noted for the most part by Shaw, our author. So, for example, Carr's poker analogy is flawed because while people normally consent to play poker and they understand that it involves bluffing, which is a form of deception, normally people don't consent to business fraud, which can harm innocent people and which can invalidate business exchanges. Okay, so that's a key difference. Second, and Shaw says this, and a lot of people would agree with it, to the extent that some practice can adversely affect human welfare, just in virtue of that fact, it's subject to moral assessment. Okay, and certainly business can very seriously affect, sometimes adversely, human welfare, right? Because if you pass off something as safe when it's not, people could seriously be injured. And also, when people engage in fraud, they can seriously harm people. Okay, now furthermore, I think that Carr is confused because of his belief that that the best way to understand morality is to just see it as centered on personal sacrifice. Because I think that although I suppose there are obviously ethical theories that can emphasize personal sacrifice, and there may be times when such things are noble, the fact of the matter is that if you want to talk about business and what kind of morality is relevant to business, it seems to me you need to acknowledge certain things. You need to acknowledge that we have a shared common interest in creating a context for business exchange in which there's mutual benefit. Okay? So business enables us to increase a benefit. And I don't want to go into all these different theories, but let me just say this. I enjoy going, let's say, to Dunkin' Donuts to get coffee. Not so much donuts, because I don't eat many donuts, but I like coffee. And whenever I give them money at Dunkin' Donuts for the coffee, I value the coffee more than the money, and the people on the other end of the counter value the money more than the coffee. I value the coffee more than the money. They value the money more than the coffee. We're both self-interested, right? But because we can have different values and we can have different priorities, we can engage in a mutually beneficial exchange. See? So it's in our interest to create a framework for mutually beneficial transactions in business. Okay, so we want to have some degree of fairness. We want to have some degree of transparency. We want to have laws against the initiation of force. We want to have laws against fraud. Okay, so we have an interest. You know, so the thing about Carr is, Carr thinks, well, all businesses should be required to do is follow the law, and that's all. They shouldn't be. In fact, businesses that tend to be successful are businesses that tend to care about their customers. And whether you're talking about Costco or whether you're talking about Amazon or whether you're talking about Trader Joe's or whether you're talking about Whole Foods, generally they try to create a context for mutually beneficial transactions. And those businesses that are most skilled at that in a competitive market are typically the businesses that are most successful. So let's just say that we have a shared interest in having successful business and having successful business transactions that are win-win. Whereas car is emphasizing this idea of a game in which you have winners and losers thing. And I think that that is really short-sighted when it comes to the logic of successful businesses in a market-dominated economy. Okay, so furthermore, you need to evaluate the, I said the divine will or the divine command theory. And we say that, well, the divine command theory says that standards of right and wrong emanate from God and ultimately are tied to God. And there are all sorts of questions about it. It's a very common traditional theory. It's been very popular historically, and it still is popular among a lot of people. But Shaw says that even though many people learn about morality through religion, that the fact of the matter is we all have a common interest in preventing and or reducing social conflict and preventing and reducing suffering. And we can create various institutions and create various practices and avoid various destructive practices because of that common interest. That we don't necessarily have to agree on religion or belief in God to make moral judgments. Furthermore, if you look at some of the most important moral guidance in, let's just say, the Bible, thou shalt not kill, well, typically that means thou shalt not murder. But then you can always have questions about how to apply that. To what degree does that apply to warfare and to particular wars? To what degree does that apply to euthanasia? To what degree does that apply to abortion? To what degree does that apply to self-defense? So, in other words, we still need to use our individual moral judgment to apply the various rules that are supposed to be within within some scripture. Furthermore, scripture itself can be subject to different interpretations, right? I mean, if you look at, let's just take the death penalty, and just take the Bible, let's say. If you go by the Hebrew scriptures, or what some people call the Old Testament, it's pretty clear that there were numerous death penalties. I'm not saying they were always followed, but they were on the books, so to speak, many of them, including for violating the Sabbath and for a number of other things. Right? And so, but if you go to the New Testament, things get a little trickier because you can find things in the New Testament, such as Jesus saying, "Let him who has not sinned cast the first stone," when it came to this woman who was presumably guilty of adultery. So there it looks like he was thinking we shouldn't have, or at least for that particular case, there should not be the death penalty. And yet there are other places, as in Matthew, where Jesus seems to be saying you should follow every jot and tittle of the law, meaning, of course, the Mosaic law, not the Roman law. And then the Mosaic law had a number of death penalties. So things get really tricky once you start to, and that's just within the Bible. And so that's why you could have Christians, for example, differing on the death penalty. You can have certain evangelical Christians, I'm not saying all of them, but some of them, let's say, may be in favor of the death penalty. And then you could have some Catholic priests who are opposed to it. Although historically, the Roman Catholic Church did have certain death penalties in the past, or it approved of them. But anyway. Okay, so those are some of the difficulties of the divine command theory. I mean, determining, well, even if you, first of all, of course, it assumes that a perfect God exists, but even with that assumption, how can we know that we have perfectly arrived at God's will? So in any event, those are some of the difficulties of that theory. Cultural relativism, I've, of course, spoken about, and that is the theory that standards of morality, standards of normality, standards of rationality or reasonableness, and standards of beauty are created by, dependent on, and relative to each culture. Okay, so And I'm especially concerned with the claim that standards of morality are created by, dependent on, and relative to each culture. So then the question is, what are some difficulties with this view? Well, one of the difficulties with that view is that the view seems to imply that practices that seem clearly to violate something even as basic as the golden rule, treat people the way one want to be treated, that those practices can be right in a society where those practices are popular and institutionalized. So if you had some systematic genocide of whether Jewish people, Gypsies, gay people, as in Nazi Germany, then it would seem that an unqualified cultural relativism would say that those things are right in a particular culture, not simply considered right, but in fact right. And that seems really odd, right? And furthermore, if somebody is just incorrect about the real effects of actions, such as suppose some tribe thinks that masturbation is dangerous when it's not, they could condemn it erroneously. And yet, according to cultural relativism, the condemnation would automatically be free from any, or should be free from criticism, because that's just their view. But if you ask them, why do you believe this is wrong, this practice, it's wrong because it's harmful. But if they're wrong about that, then you would think that would be one way in which you could criticize the moral norm against that and their moral judgments based on erroneous information. So, in a way, it's interesting because cultural relativism, and let's talk especially about its ethical dimension, seems to regard moral norms as kind of, in a sense, conventions without having or needing to have any rationality behind them. They're just conventions that people have. It's just like people have rules for Monopoly. We have rules for Monopoly for how the game is played. Sometimes people have house rules they add to it, but in general, they're rules that define Monopoly and the moves within them, and then same thing with chess and other games. And we don't say of those rules, are they wise, are they true? We don't say that. We just say, well, those just are the rules, right? Well, that makes sense in relation to those games. But if you think that it's legitimate to expect moral norms to do certain things, such as reduce or prevent social conflict and to reduce or prevent suffering, then theoretically you could evaluate various moral codes according to how well they achieve those goals. And yet, cultural relativism seems not to want to do that, or at least advocates of cultural relativism don't seem to think that you can that it's legitimate to have certain norms to evaluate various moral codes. That each moral code is supposed to, in a sense, be autonomous and judged only by itself. But anyway, these are some of the ways in which people have criticized the ethical dimension of cultural relativism. And then the by the way, everything I've talked about in for essays, or also most of what I've said will be echoed in the book when the book discusses those theories that will be discussed in the essay. Now there's one view that you could write about that is not discussed in the book. I think it's mentioned, but it's certainly not evaluated. And that is the principle, and some people say it's Marxist, but it certainly was created even before Marx, and there are other people other than Marxists who have held to it, but from each according to his ability, and of course his or her ability, to each according to his or her need. Okay? So the question is, how would you evaluate that? Do you think that if we ended up doing this generally throughout society, that we would discourage innovation? Would we discourage hard work? Would, if people could be guaranteed that they could live at least reasonably comfortably while doing little work, do you think that that would promote a growing economy, an innovative economy? Do you think that the more successful someone was in the marketplace, the more we would take from that person to give to others? Do you think that could discourage people from being more innovative and more productive? So what I want you to do is think about that. And, you know, and then think about the different kinds of economies, East Germany versus West Germany during the Cold War. Or, you know, you could think about, you could just go down the lot and just think about how productive the former Soviet Union was relative to the U.S., how productive historically Cuba was after the Communist Revolution compared to, let's say, Hong Kong, which has historically had for many years the freest economy. Not necessarily the people in Hong Kong, not necessarily politically the freest, but economically, for many, many years, they have had the freest economy. And you look at the per capita income and the level of innovation and productivity there as opposed to, let's say, Cuba. But anyway, you may not even want to cover that question, from each according to his or her ability, to each according to his or her need. Again, it's not covered in the book. The other parts, the other essays, possible essays, are covered, at least the subject matter of those essays. But in any event, I pretty much covered what I wanted to cover today for this review for the first test. I just want to remind you that the test is going to be true, false, multiple choice, and essay.